Adequate notice of this March 7th, 2022 regular monthly meeting, originally scheduled for February 28th, 2022 of the Cranford Board of Education, was provided on February 23rd, 2022 by a meeting notice posted in the boardroom, Lincoln School, and communicated to the Star Ledger, the Westfield Leader, the Office of the Township Clerk, and all board members. Please rise for the flag salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mrs. Carbone.
Here.
Mr. Darling.
Here.
Mr. Dreyer.
Here.
Mr. Hulse.
Here.
Mrs. Kessler. Mrs. Loika.
Here.
Mr. Lynch.
Here.
Mrs. Mallon.
Here.
Mr. Petchow.
Here.
We have quorum.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Rubin, I'm going to throw it right to you.
Great. Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Very nice to see you in person this evening. We usually start off with going to our board liaisons, and we are going to get to them in just a moment. But before we do that, I want to start off with telling you about an amazing act of heroism that happened over at Orange Avenue School a couple of weeks ago. Just absolutely extraordinary. And so in order for me to tell it, I'm just going to need a couple people to step up while I'm telling it. If I can get Juliet McLeod, fourth grader over at OAS, if you can just kind of come by the podium, and then I'm going to ask if Mrs. Smith, Marjorie Smith, can join you up near the podium. So these two extraordinary individuals. A couple weeks ago, we had a student over at Orange Avenue School during the cafeteria, during lunchtime, who started to choke on some food. And Juliet, very alert, noticed that student was in trouble and absolutely made sure that our lunch aide, Mrs. Smith, was well aware of it and signaled for her to come over. Mrs. Smith, seemingly cape appeared out of nowhere, bounded over to the student that was in need, administered the Heimlich, was able to make sure that student was okay, and both of these students made sure that we're here tonight to celebrate something wonderful as opposed to something that could have been very, very tragic. So let's give them a really nice round of applause. Juliet, thank you for not panicking, for knowing exactly what to do and going to get help for one of your friends. And Ms. Smith, oh my goodness, thank you for the care in which you provided and making sure to help our students. And we actually have a couple of proclamations here that we would like to share. Mr. Petchow, would you like to read? This is the first one for Juliet.
Okay, so this one's for you, Juliet. Whereas Juliet McLeod is a fourth grade student at Orange Avenue School, and whereas Juliet McLeod recognized that another student was in distress and choking, and whereas Juliet McLeod remained calm and acted quickly in notifying Marjorie Smith, the classroom lunchroom assistant, that her urgent assistance was required. Whereas Juliet McLeod is to be commended for her swift response and her critical part in bringing attention to a matter that was potentially life-threatening and serious. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Superintendent of Schools and the Cranford Board of Education wish to acknowledge, thank, commend, and offer their sincere appreciation for the successful action of Juliet McLeod.
I know that was an awful lot, and we don't mean to embarrass you, but congratulations.
Congratulations.
Well done. Great job. Great job. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, hold on. We've got a proclamation for you, too.
That's right. You can't leave, Ms. Smith. Sorry.
You're going to have to be up there a little bit longer. Sorry. I know. And by the way, Ms. Smith, as humble as she was heroic, she did not jump at the chance to be here publicly and be acknowledged. That certainly was not why she had done any of this. But I insisted when we were on the phone, we need to celebrate you publicly. So I appreciate you enduring this. This was not, as a true hero, did this for students, not for recognition. So.
Okay, Ms. Smith, this one is for you. Whereas Marjorie Smith is a classroom lunchroom assistant at Orange Avenue School, and whereas Marjorie Smith was made aware by Juliet McLeod of another student in distress and choking on food, and whereas Marjorie Smith remained calm and focused and was able to successfully administer the Heimlich maneuver to dislodge the obstruction, and whereas Marjorie Smith is to be commended for her quick response, knowledge, and the successful outcome of an incident that was potentially life-threatening and serious. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Superintendent of Schools and the Cranford Board of Education wish to acknowledge, thank, commend, and offer their sincere appreciation for the successful action of Marjorie Smith.
And I know we also have the student who was choking, as well as a very grateful and appreciative mom in the audience as well. And so we certainly thank you. I don't want to put you on the spot. If you want to say something, that's great. If not, we certainly.
I just want to thank you all. Thank you for honoring these two. We're so grateful. I'm so glad that we're standing here and that they acted so quickly and that nothing went awry. So.
And we are very happy to see you, and certainly your son in great spirits and great health. So thank you, and thank you for being such heroes. We're certainly a better community with all of you in it. So thank you very much. Wonderful, wonderful. Excellent. So now we'll take a look and hear from our liaisons. We'll go over to, let's go over to Hillside first. Do we have Zach Ryan and Yuxi Zhang in person for the first time here? If you want to come up to the microphone right here. And we'd love to hear from you and all the great happenings that are going on over at Hillside.
So as a big date, March 7th came around, Master now optional in HIS, and although many schools have them, or many students have them off, still many students have them on, and everybody has been accepting and kind to the students who still have their masks on. And another huge thank you to our custodians for the hard work keeping everybody safe during the still pandemic and keeping the schools clean. And also, we started Water Jug Wars, which is a competition between each middle school grade for a fundraiser for Rise Against Hunger, where all the money placed in a jar from each grade gets funded for our Rise Against Hunger. And it's a competition between each grade. And the sixth grade class grade, which won a movie day for the whole grade. And then, as we celebrate our National School Counselors Week with the theme of Better Together, students were able to complete a Google form that helped explain why our school counselors are better together. Special shout out to Mr. Brito, Mrs. Ciliano, and Mr. Kelly. Sorry about that. And finally, the Cranford JCs has donated $7,000 to HIS to fund new instruments for HIS now, because HIS and OAS used to share instruments, but now with the fundraising from the JCs, we are able to now have each separate instruments. Now I'm going to pass it on to our vice president. So the band String Orchestra and Chorus, they recently had their winter concert, and we were all excited to have our live performance this year because last year we had to do like a virtual recording, and it wasn't a great experience. But the students were performing, that like includes me, because I'm a part of orchestra and chorus, and I know I was nervous, but I was also really excited to start performing again. And right now, we are all getting ready for the spring concert and like excited for that. And on the topic of performing, the HES musical has been pushed to the weekend of April 1st in 2022. And students will still not be able to perform without their masks, but they're still working hard for the performance. And the current 8th grade students have completed scheduling for the 9th grade, when they will be attending the high school. And lastly, HES has been lucky enough to become a grief-informed school. 6th graders have been attending workshops that help them become aware of different strategies to cope with loss and hurt. So, yeah. Thank you.
It's great. Let's give them a really nice round of applause. Both of you did an excellent job. You know, this is the first time that these students have been able to do this in person. And, you know, for those of you who haven't done this before, you can certainly imagine it is not the easiest thing to come into this room and go ahead and address folks and television being here and be able to express themselves. You did an excellent job at that. We appreciate you sharing all the wonderful information. Really fabulous. Excited to hear about the different events. Excited to hear about the accepting nature of our schools, charitable events. All the other different events are wonderful. The shows at each of the schools. I think the high school had already been beyond the March 7th, but all the other shows were able to be moved back so that people could avail themselves of the mask optional piece there. So it's just wonderful that we've got all these different things going on at all the schools, and I appreciate you giving that update. Let's give them another nice round of applause, please. And I'd also like to give a nice hand. I see their advisor, Mr. Wiley, in the background. So thank you very much for all you do with these students and our community at large. Let's go ahead and head over to Orange Avenue School. I think we've got Ross and Lauren. Come on up. Oh, no, maybe I don't. I've got, no, come on up. Vanessa?
Yes.
And Lauren, sorry, yes.
All right, good evening, everyone. It's so nice to finally be here in person after being here for 2 years. So thank you so much for having us tonight. To begin, we want to start off with current events in OAS.
Currently at OAS, the practices for the musical are running pretty smoothly. Performances for The Wizard of Oz will start on the 16th and on the 18th. There is a chance that the show will be performed without masks, but has not been decided yet. And you should definitely come see the show because you will be able to see lovely me as the Wicked Witch of the West. Last week, elementary students got to step into the spotlight and showcase their amazing skills, which we are so proud of, in their concert. I guess a little showcase concert, I would call it. A very big thank you to Miss Amanda Holodak and Miss Karen Makoviak for the band portion, and to Mr. Jonathan Jackson for the orchestra portion. We're also looking forward to the start of spring sports with tryouts starting in a week. Good luck to all those trying out, and now I would like to pass it over to Vanessa.
So yes, I am Vanessa, and as you all know, today was the first day without masks being mandatory in school. And we just want to thank all the staff who made this possible. They made sure it was safe for us to take them off and have been keeping us safe so we remain in person out this year. Also, we are so grateful for the PTA who funded the Rutgers Science Bus. They gave us this amazing opportunity and is a hands-on learning experience straight from Rutgers for all middle school. Throughout this week, OAS students have been taught about the topics of respect, kindness, mindfulness, acceptance, and empathy to celebrate Social Emotional Learning Week. These five components being taught can teach students how to live their lives happy and healthy and help us build a strong school community. Thank you so much for your time. We just hope we can make it in person tonight.
absolutely wonderful. Once again, not as easy as they make it look, but they certainly did make it look easy. You did a fabulous job. Thank you for sharing all the information that's going on in the schools. We're looking forward to the performances for sure. And I know that April in particular, OAS in particular, was coming up. They were like the earliest of all the events, and they were pushed back specifically so that they could be mask optional or mask choice for those students. So we look forward to those productions. Again, right, it's up to people to decide what's best for them and their families. And I love the fact that in the first session, we talked about the, you know, people having an accepting nature to make sure that those that choose to wear one feel comfortable and those who do not choose to wear one feel comfortable. So I think that's fabulous. And again, thank you so much for all you do for the school. And Ms. Lefkowitz, thank you for being here and also representing. She is their advisor. So let's give her a nice round of applause. Unfortunately, we do not have our usual board liaisons for the high school, both very busy, very active, lots of different commitments. So unfortunately, they were not able to cover for each other tonight, but they send their greetings, and we look forward to their report at a future board meeting. I just wanted to follow up on a correspondence that I had recently sent out to the community. I think I had sent it out last Wednesday. As you know, things change pretty quickly throughout this pandemic. And, you know, whenever we get additional and new guidance, we update the community as promptly as possible. So I did share in that correspondence the updated appendix for the Road Forward COVID-19 health and safety protocols. I also included in there the, moving towards normalcy, because that is exactly what we're doing. You know that the state had announced, or the governor had announced, that lifting of the universal mask mandate effective today, and Cranford Public Schools, I think the next day had announced that we were going to follow those guidelines. And so today was the first day that students could take advantage of that. And certainly we saw lots of students who had took advantage of that. And as you had pointed out, there were also students who would prefer to continue wearing their masks. And again, I can't say it enough times. Let's remind people, it is essential that we all work together to promote an atmosphere where everyone can feel comfortable with their family choices. We are certainly sharing that and promoting that in each of our classrooms and in our school community. We ask that that parents and guardians continue to partner with us and have those conversations at home as well to make sure that everyone is being empathetic and sympathetic to what everyone's viewpoints and decisions are, and that we respect everyone's viewpoints. So we've seen lots of evidence that that is happening, and we want that to continue. All of this, lifting the mask, part of our safe and incremental move towards normalcy, which started late January, early February. I had sent out a few different correspondences, sort of, letting people know what were the changes that we're making based on, you know, guidelines that we've received and based on the data and, of course, working with our local health office. We've seen a dramatic improvement in the numbers on the statewide, regional, and here locally in Cranford. So we're very encouraged. We already talked about the masking piece of that. We also, in the correspondence, I discussed the test to stay program. In the past, if someone was a close contact and asymptomatic, they would have had to wait, 5 days. They could come back on the sixth day, as long as they were wearing their mask and symptoms improving and or staying asymptomatic. Now students can come back immediately the following day, still wearing the mask, but as long as they tested negative on the first, third, and fifth day. So they've got that opportunity as we go forward. Distancing 3 feet in the classroom, but now desks can be podded and grouped together. Lunch used to be 6 feet. Now it is 3 feet. We brought back the cafeteria tables. Recess, obviously, and today was a nice example of it. Students were able to go outside, and they were also unpodded. I know this is very important at the elementary school level, so they were able to congregate and meet with other students across the grade level, not just in their classes. We know how important that is, so we're able to do that. And I know at the high school, one of the things that was on people's minds is this was the first year that we had open campus, not just for the seniors, but also it was really grades 9 through 12. And I know a concern for students was, you know, is that going to change sort of month to month? We've decided that we would keep that open campus system in place for 9 through 12 throughout the rest of the year. And we're in discussions now about what that may look like in the future for next year and what that setup will look like. So we've been having those kinds of conversations, and we'll update the community once we come to those conclusions. I also share that, you know, keeping the community safe is really a shared responsibility. And so one of the major thing that everyone can do and assist us is just keep your children home when they're sick. And notify the nurse so that we can work through and give you a pathway. But, you know, certainly keeping students home when they're sick is the best way to help out everyone. And then the other piece I would say is that we are very optimistic that we're on the right pathway and continuing towards normalcy. I had mentioned in the letter that within the next 2 weeks, we really believe that we're going to, be going to that green level, that green transmission level. You know, the New Jersey Department of Health releases their CALI report, their COVID activity level indicator report every week on Thursdays. Of course, this day they made us wait this week, last week, and it wasn't until Friday. We were still in the yellow, moderate, but like very close to green, like really, really close, like a percentage point off. So we're very hopeful that that as early as this Thursday we'll be in that green, which is very positive. Also, late last week, the CDC released guidance pertaining to contact tracing and quarantining and those sorts of things. We know that the state is reviewing that information now. So, we think that their information from the CDC, as well as potentially going to green this week, coupled with what we're seeing at the local level, really could result in really drastic changes to how we quarantine and do contact tracing. So it is very likely that you'll be hearing updates from this district very, very soon. And, we look forward to providing that update. And truthfully, we really thank you for all of your patience, flexibility, and partnership as we navigated through this. I know people throw out words like uncharted territory and unprecedented, you know, and sometimes they sort of, you know, perhaps lose their meaning or effect. I mean, this really has been unprecedented and uncharted. It really has been. And it has really been a group effort to keep all of us safe. I think Cranford has really done an amazing job and been exemplary from the beginning to the end in making really good decisions in the best interests of our community, working with our local health department, following the guidance, and keeping our community safe while, making reasonable decisions with all of those experts. So again, all of you had a part in that. We've had pandemic committees made up of parents, made up of our teachers, our administrative team, community members, you know, everybody, our safety professionals, our board members. And so we really, once again, appreciate everyone's assistance and partnership as we go forward. And hopefully, with every passing day, we seem to be putting it further and further in the rearview mirror. So thank you very much. And that is my report, Mr. President.
Thank you, Dr. Rubin. Does anybody have any questions for Dr. Rubin before I give it over to Bob? Okay. Bob, I'm throwing it to you. Sorry about that.
No, that was my fault. I should have been more prepared. Thank you, Mr. Petchow. The only item in my report is Resolution 5 that's on tonight's agenda. It is to approve an agreement with the Township of Cranford for the replacement of the turf at the original Memorial Field, or the original turf field at Memorial, I should say. And it also replaces the running track. I'd like to thank Mr. Hulse, Mr. Petchow, and the Buildings and Grounds Committee for working on this. We've been on this for a while, and they also went to a township committee meeting when this agreement was on the township agenda. So a lot of stakeholders have been involved in this, and we appreciate all the support from all the groups. We've been meeting on this, it seems like, for a couple of years, or even pre-COVID, when before COVID started, because we are in need to replace the field. Its useful life has expired, and the track, its useful life has expired too. So all the groups came together to pool their interests and funding together to get this done. So I think it's a wonderful partnership with all the groups, and I'd like to thank the Township Committee and Ryan Cooper, the township attorney, for working on this and putting an agreement together that works for all parties. And in essence, we are limited on what we can do as a Board of Education to 5 years. So any agreements, any things we enter into to buy things, purchase things, issue debt, is limited to 5 years by the Department of Ed. Why I'm going through that is the field, just like the original field, will be paid off over 10 years. And that's where our partnership with the township comes into play, because they were willing to bond the improvements, pay for the job, and then we and the shareholders that are on a list, and I'll thank them in a minute, the groups in town, will pay them back, because we're not allowed statutorily to do that. So the agreement that's on tonight's agenda is to, and it's been approved by the township already, is to enter an agreement with the township that basically does that. They are willing to bond the improvements, get payback from the district and the partners that are involved in this. And the only difference from the last time we did this is we paid the township, meaning when I say we, I mean the Board of Ed. I act like I'm a Board of Ed member. I'm not, but I do say we in a nice way. The Board of Ed would pay the township back, and the individual groups who've pledged money towards this project would pay the township back. The only difference is the groups will pay us, and the Board of Education will pay the township once a year with one check. And I'm totally fine with that, because the project needs to get done, and that's just a minor bookkeeping thing. So not only are we participating in this, but I'd like to publicly thank the groups, and I'm stealing Mr. Hulse's report for later, but it is an agenda item, so sorry, William. The specific groups who've contributed funds or pledged funds for this project: the Cranford Booster Club, Hull Vici Construction, Cranford JCs, the Cranford Lacrosse Club, Cranford PAL, Cranford Soccer Club, and Statewide Fencing. They have pledged money to help pay for these improvements. If anybody else wants to pledge money, we are not shutting down the pledges or the receipt of funds. But the tune of their contributions, to be serious, is close to $200,000. And then if you have the CAT funds deposit, the Cranford Athletic Turf Fund, not to use acronyms all the time, has been fundraising since the field was completed the first time. So they have $70,000 right now to make an initial deposit on that. So you're looking at about $270,000 coming from outside groups in town, which is a wonderful thing that everybody chipped in to get this done. The difference will be paid by the Board of Education through our budget, which is very similar to what we paid in the first project. And we're getting the track done. So it's a little higher than what we had the first go around, but the track wasn't part of it. So I think it's a win-win on all groups. We are scheduled to start construction the day after graduation, because that's our only window to get this done. We'll work it out with the teams and the sports for the summer, but the best time to do it is when graduation ends, hit the ground running, and get the job started, and hopefully it'll be completed on time. Middle of August, you know, give or take. Don't quote me on that. Things happen. The bigger concern is the track, curing the track and not ruining the track. The turf, I'm not an expert, you kind of roll it out and you can play on it. Don't mean to make jokes about that, but the track is the piece that takes a little more time. So we're looking to get this approved tonight, then to send it over to the township and get the ball rolling, because it's pretty well been rolling for a while, and we just want to cross the T's and dot the I's and keep this moving. But I really want to thank all the groups and the township committee and the mayor and everybody for pitching in on this to get it done, because this is the best way to do something like this. And it shows the great partnerships we have with the groups in town and the township to get this done. So, William, I apologize, because I know that's part of your report. But we are on schedule, and we want to keep the ball rolling on that, too, because we don't want to miss that window from graduation through the summer, because we really, that field's used all the time. We don't have another opening to do it. So any questions on that? I gave you details on the pledges. And if we sign the agreement, then we can issue the contract and then get it going. Anything I missed on that? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob.
All right.
Does any board member have a communication they would like to share? Maria, please.
No, stop. Lisa Carbone and I are liaisons to the Friends of Performing Arts, and This is just a teaser because we still have over a month, but they're the downtown Cranford and the Friends of Performing Arts will be having an arts day. Very exciting. It will span all age levels from elementary school to the middle school to the high school and above, from everything from the stage, all of our music, our dancers, our actors, to the art rooms. So look for information on that. We also, the day will culminate with a film festival. So if anybody would like to buy tickets to that, that's available online. So I will be telling you more as we get closer. So thank you to our Friends of Performing Arts for letting us know all this information and for working so tirelessly to get this out. It sounds like it's going to be a really fun day. April 30th.
Thank you, Maria. Anybody have any questions for Maria before we move on? Okay, does anybody else have a communication they'd like to share? We're good? Okay, we're going to move on. We are up to our first audience participation, so if anybody would like to speak, just please come up to the mic and state your name and address, and we'll get going.
And just a reminder that this is public comment, not public Q&A, so please keep your comments to 5 minutes, and then after everyone is done with public comment, then myself and the board can respond in total. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. President. My name is Tom Grasso, Willow Street, Cranford. I want to thank the board and Dr. Rubin for going Mass Choice when it was offered. Thank you for that. But I am here to express my unhappiness with the exclusion and test to say policy implemented today. I believe the policy is ill-advised and fundamentally flawed for several reasons and should be rescinded. There is no public health emergency. It ended at midnight today. There is no law, regulation, executive order, mandate, or directive requiring test to stay be implemented. It is 100% voluntary. The policy conflicts with CDC policy in several ways. First, CDC has Union County in green on their website, low community spread. Remember, our county is lumped with two other ones, which is probably causing it to be orange in the Cali report. The state DOH reports lag behind a week from the CDC. State guidance is inconsistent with CDC's, and there is no reason for us to wait for the state to catch up. The policy is inconsistent with the CDC's stance on vaccine effectiveness. CDC director recently acknowledged that the vaccines cannot prevent transmission. That is to say, COVID is not vaccine preventable. This is supported by a recent study in New York. The test to stay policy is based on a false premise that vaccinations prevent transmission. In reality, they don't. CDC no longer recommends universal case investigation and contact tracing, but rather recommends it only for specific settings like long-term care facilities and homeless shelters. Also, the CDC does not recommend vaccinated confirmed COVID-positive students stay in class. The test-to-stay policy is inconsistent with neighboring Union County towns. Summit, Garwood, Scotch Plains, Clark do not require it or do not have it in place. Why Cranford? What is so uniquely different here? What risks exist here that don't exist in the other towns? People are going about their lives here in restaurants, sports training, large social functions. Why are schools targeted? Last June, we went mask optional with no such measures. Why now? The policy on its face discriminates against unvaccinated children. The policy permits vaccinated, asymptomatic, confirmed COVID-positive children to stay in school unmasked and carry on normally. Meanwhile, vaccinated, asymptomatic, close contacts are presumed positive and excluded from school outright for 5 days and are required to wear a mask when returning to school for another week. Why the disparate treatment? Under test to stay, unvaccinated may test 3 times the first week to stay in school. But if a child cannot be vaccinated because of religious beliefs, they're segregated from school and friends on a mere presumption of illness. That conflicts with Article 1, Section 5 of the New Jersey Constitution, which prohibits segregation on religious grounds. Why should asymptomatic children be segregated and asked to submit to 3 tests in order to attend schools they have a constitutional right to attend in the absence of a public health emergency or legal requirement to do so? The test to say policy also conflicts with current Board of Ed equity and inclusion policies. Policy 2260 and Policy 1160 require equal access for all students to all school facilities, regardless of race, creed, etc. 1160 The board is required to recognize and value the diversity of persons and promote their acceptance, celebration, and appreciation of all persons. We heard that tonight. The policy also requires the board to provide a learning environment that is free from all prejudice and discrimination. Policies 2260 and 1160 are required by law. The voluntary test to say policy discriminates between vaxxed and unvaxxed children and treats them unequally and inherently violates these two existing and legally required policies and therefore violates the law. We swore an oath to uphold the law and Constitution. Law prevails over policy. The test to say policy promotes a culture of vaccine discrimination. The Board of Ed's constitutional and statutory mandate is to provide a free and equal education for all children in the district. Discrimination in any form cannot be accepted or tolerated. How is test to say enforced in the classroom? Is the teacher provided the student's confidential personal health information and expected to police the student? The teachers need to be focused on education, not mask policing, especially given the learning loss of the past three school years. Lastly, test to say policy does not benefit our children. Cranford parents and students have endured three school years of restrictions. Today was beautiful, full of smiles, yet the test to say policy lurks under the radar, ready to strike and take out swathes of students from classrooms. Imagine how a child will feel when that happens. What good will that serve? Ultimately, the imposition of complicated and draconian COVID measures at this stage are untimely and completely out of step with reality.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else like to come up and make comments, please?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Ron Baruti, 307 Casino Avenue. I'm speaking as a citizen and taxpayer tonight. With respect to test to stay, this board is obviously is required to be on notice of all laws that affect the things that they're doing. And I would just note that currently there are no vaccines available that are not emergency use authority vaccines. There have been two approved vaccines, which are Comirnaty, Pfizer, and Spikevax, which is from Moderna. Neither one is available in the United States right now. Therefore, every single vaccine that is available is an emergency use authority vaccine. Under 21 U.S.C. Section 360, triple B, also known as FDCA Section 564, anybody who is given the option to have an emergency use vaccine, drug, or anything else is entitled to say no. And they're entitled absolutely to reject that vaccine. And under 45 CFR, Section 45-116, small b, 8, which is the informed consent regulation, which applies to FDCA 564. It says a statement that participation is voluntary means refusal to participate will there will be involved no penalty or loss of benefits to which the subject is otherwise entitled. To the extent that this board is going to put in a policy which punishes students and their families for making the choice not to be vaccinated with an EUA vaccine, I respectfully suggest to you all that you're violating the law, federal law. Federal law will trump any state law. It's under the Supremacy Clause of the United States Constitution, and federal law, obviously the Constitution has supremacy. So I just, I'd ask you that you reconsider this policy, because I do believe that in effecting this policy, this Board of Education will be breaking the law. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else want to make comments or questions? Thank you.
Good evening. It's good to actually see each of your faces tonight. My name is Vincent Moretti. I know I do. That was a dig. 5 Middlebury Lane. I actually just became aware of the test to stay policy, which is what brought me to the meeting tonight. My concerns with the, aside from what the concerns that have already been shared, one of my concerns with test to stay is I'm confused as to how it could be unbiasedly implemented in a classroom. So, for instance, if there's a child that's exposed to another student in a class, does that mean the entire class is going to be forced to go home for 5 days if they were all exposed? How do you know if or when they were exposed? And how do you delineate or differentiate between the students who might or might not have been exposed? Finally, how do you know where they were exposed? If COVID has taught us anything, there's really no way for us to, as much as we've all put our best foot forward, to really understand where we're catching the virus. And then when we make the take the measures to mitigate further exposure or further spread, a lot of times it's already after the fact and other people have already been exposed. So my concern with this is I feel like it's another draconian way of trying to contain or control something that, at the end of the day, the CDC has acknowledged, I believe not long ago today, that it's going to become like the flu and everything else that we have to just deal with every year. That's not to say that it doesn't matter or that should be ignored, but children, I believe, are ultimately going to feel that they are the reason that this is happening, that they're the victims of this. You know, there's no number system at this table when you guys have to decide who's going to sit where. There's no 5 days of testing if you're not feeling well. Yes, it's expected that you would stay home and not expose other people, but to have children who maybe were or maybe were not exposed suffer because somebody maybe has COVID or is asymptomatic, or even if that person stays home, I don't know how that's getting us to normalcy. So that's my concern as a parent. I'm encouraged by the fact that we are green, or that we're very close to green. Hopefully this isn't something that we have to implement. My final comment is, again, related to the number system I heard about today from my sons, that there's numbers being drawn as far as where children need to eat at lunch. Now, I don't know if this is district-wide or if this is just at Brookside, but there is a number system where they are being segregated, and I'm not sure what the point of that is, except to potentially monitor exposure and... But again, you could be exposed all day long. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be at lunch. So I would like an explanation as to what this number system is and why children can't choose to sit with other children now that they're being told that they don't have to wear masks and that things are getting better. That's all I have. So thanks for your time, and it's good to see you. Thanks.
Thank you.
Grace.
How are you doing? Antonio Puglisi, Livingston Avenue. First of all, thank you. The last couple of years have been very challenging. I spent 7 years on the Board of Education locally, 2 years on the Board of Health. I know it's not easy, Tony. Familiar with you. So my question is, you know, regarding the contact tracing, and I guess I'm just reiterating what was asked recently, how is that going to be, you know, taken care of? How is it going to be efficient? Or accurate. So essentially, if somebody's eating lunch, somebody tested positive, then that kid goes back to class, then they go to gym, maybe pass somebody in the bathroom, even though they might not be in there for 15 minutes. So my question is, how is that going to be accurate and effective where it won't be as disruptive so that the teacher can continue to teach and the kids can continue to learn? This last 2 years, I feel like everything's just been off balance, and it's taken 10 times the effort, I'm sure, as you can as well have felt, to get things done. So that's essentially just my question at this point, because everybody else has kind of, you know, done a good job. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Does anybody else have any questions or comments? Please.
So I had this whole speech and I scrapped it. So I'm just going to say this. I was reading my book this morning and I came across this great quote, and it said, "People only see what they are prepared to see," and it's from Ralph Waldo Emerson. And it's in this fictional book, but I thought it was great. And the reason that I'm saying that is because I think as a Board of Education and a health officer and as people and human beings, you know, again, we're teaching No Place to Hate in the district. we're teaching self-care, SEL, I had a great responsibility of teaching history. I took that very seriously. If you're going to say that you want people to be kind and to respect and to encompass everyone, you have to do it truly, genuinely, for everyone. You cannot just put up flags on your lawn, and you cannot put little rings around your Facebook pictures and then install discriminatory practices in the school system under the guise of health when everything that Tom said is true. I'm sorry, but it has been 2 years of changing science. The truth is that science is a process, that we all know this. We went to high school science classes. We took college science classes. We know that the scientific theory are things that you test over time. It's a discipline. That's how it works, right? So at the end of the day, if you want people to feel safe and secure and to truly love the world that they're in and treat each other with compassion, then you need to set policies that truly promote that. And I am a big believer in my own responsibility for myself. I do the things to take care of myself, and that means I have to live a life that's true to that. So if I take care of my own health, I do that. But I also need to live a life where I take care of other people in a genuine and a way that is full of integrity. So I have to come up here and say the things that I need to say where I'm truly living that, which is why I just had to come up here and say that today. And I just hope that Cranford can do that, because I need to live in a town that doesn't hide discrimination in a policy. And that's honestly how I feel. I don't want to live in that town.
Thank you.
Anybody else want to come up and comment? Please.
So, this is the Constitution. It's a document that none of you seem to be familiar with. Okay? This is the First Amendment to the Constitution. These are amendments to the Constitution. The First Amendment says that Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise of or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or of the right of the people to peacefully assemble or to petition the government for a redress of grievances. We start every meeting here doing what? Saluting the flag. Saluting the flag. Does that mean anything to anyone in this room? You ask when you salute the flag for liberty and justice for all. And do you know that the Constitution of the United States is the highest law in the land? There is nothing that surmounts the Constitution, and certainly not a low-level Board of Education policy. And you all, Board of Ed members, took an oath, an ethics oath, and in it, you swore to protect laws and rules and regulations, and nowhere does it say in the oath that you took to be Board of Education members for this town, nowhere does it say the word policy. And I can't imagine when I walked away arrested, when you have children in this town with me, I've been in many of your homes, and we're neighbors, that all of you felt good about that decision. I can't imagine that that felt okay with all of you, but no one came forward and said, this is not the right thing to do. Now, think about Anne Frank. The people that held Anne Frank and her family were breaking the law. The people that took her family away, okay, and killed them, they were the people following the law. And I think that in 50 years, when my case suing this Board of Education and the police and Dr. Rubin and Tony Scarello and his firm is in law books and is learned, in 50 years, you are the people that are going to be looked at in the same way as the people that took away Anne Frank's family who were following the law. And that must not feel very good. But you only have yourself to blame. And I don't want to hear from people that this is wasting the money of the taxpayers of Cranford. You bet it is. I'm outraged as a taxpayer and as a citizen and as a parent with my two kids in this school. I'm outraged at the actions of this board and of this superintendent and of the board's attorney, who I don't know how, as an attorney myself, is still sitting here giving legal advice to this board. I can't even imagine how this board is allowing that to occur. You are costing this town hundreds of thousands of dollars at the end of the day. Every single one of you. And you should resign. All of you. And the superintendent should give up his position. You have broken the law. This is the Constitution. The most important law. And you know what you guys did? You spit on the Constitution. And that is shameful.
Does anybody else have any comments or questions? I don't see any, Doc, so if you want to start answering us some of those things, we can.
Sure. Yeah, thank you. So just a few comments. So first off, obviously, this pandemic has been hard on everybody. Whether you're a parent, whether you're a teacher, whether you're a student, whether you're in administration, the pandemic has impacted everybody. It has not spared anybody. Our goal is to navigate it safely. We do it in partnership with the local health department and follow the state guidance. We are, and our goal right now is to get to as normal as we possibly can. We've demonstrated that, time after time. We're continuing to do that. The guidance that people are referring to in terms of test to stay, our goal is to get kids back as quickly as possible and for them not to miss any days. This is the recommendation from the New Jersey Department of Health, and this is also the recommendation from the local health department, so we are following that guidance in partnership with them. As I said in my opening statements, things are changing very quickly. Like I said, the CDC came out with updated guidance. That's under review right now. And we're also following the Cali reports, which we hope are turning green very soon. And so it's quite possible that we will pivot once again very soon based on that information. That is certainly our hope, and that the data indicates that. So people should expect to be hearing from us very soon as hopefully things continue to go in a positive direction. In terms of close contacts or how to identify exposed students, it's still based on the close contacts. Admittedly, it's much more challenging to do that now with the state of unmasked, but they haven't changed the close contact definition. So we'll do our best to identify folks in the best way that we can. I don't know the gentleman that was talking about Brookside, Mr. Peretti. I'm not sure. My suggestion is to reach out to Mr. Klimko directly. He'd be, he's incredibly accessible and available. Would be happy to discuss that with you. I suspect what you're referring to is probably what they've devised, maybe to help answer the question that other people were asking in terms of close context. But again, I don't want to step out too far. I don't really know what that is. But if Mr. Klimko is behind it, I'm sure it's something that's been thought out and focused on what's best for kids. So I would reach out to him and ask him specifically about that. And like I said, I understand it's been difficult for everybody. Our goal is to continue and to try to get as much normalcy safely as possible. And we'll continue to follow that guidance and also work with our local health department, which is what our duty is. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rubin. Okay, we are going to move on to older new business and committee reports. I'm going to start with you, Kristen. Yes, please.
The curriculum committee met on February 28th. Just two quick things from that meeting. Ms. Hayek, the science supervisor, presented the new AP Environmental Science textbook, which is Resolution 12 tonight. And the committee was very impressed with her presentation and what this book is going to mean for our students in APES. Also, Mr. Deacon and Mrs. Lubieski-Hutmaker came to discuss the progress that is being made on the middle school scheduling. They had a lot of actually interesting, I thought, information to share on how they have gotten to where they're at. So they'll be coming back again, I believe, once they continue to meet with their committee. There is challenges, and we have known that for years, that changing middle school schedules, there's lots of hurdles. But they're doing a great job, so, and it was great to hear from them. Thanks, Kurt.
Thank you, Kristen. Does anybody have any questions for Kristen? Good. All right. Patrick, I'm going to go over to you. You said you had two.
Yep. I have two committee reports. First, in Finance Committee met on February 17th. Topics discussed on the agenda were the fiscal year 2021 budget audit, so statutory completion dates, March 15th. At the time we met, the auditor was just waiting for some pension information from the state to complete the audit. The committee reviewed the preliminary 2022-2023 budget and the timeline. Of note, the governor's budget address is tomorrow, March 8th. In terms of the timeline following that, the March 14th would be the board meeting that we as board members vote to send the preliminary budget to the executive county superintendent for review and approval, assuming there are no issues there, and we get that back. The public hearing on the budget for the 2022-2023 budget, the public hearing would be on April 25th. And Bob, please correct me if I misstated anything regarding the timeline or the budget. Good. All right. The second meeting that I wanted to touch on was Personnel Committee met on February 23rd. Three items of discussion had to do with a leave of absence request. We discussed the non-tenured teachers and non-tenured administrative review cycle process that was completed, and we touched on the superintendent evaluation timeline and process. Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick. Does anybody have any questions on any of those items? Okay, William, I know you have the buildings and grounds.
Mr. Carfagno covered a lot of the buildings and grounds, meaning in reference to the turf and the track. Again, I just want to reiterate that we want to thank the Township Committee. They played a big part in this, and along with all the partners that Mr. Carfagno spoke of. I also just want to make it clear, too, we did not accept any county funds, which I think is important to start getting that word out. With the field now, we accepted county funds from that field that's currently there. So we have to let other people come and use that field. By us not taking county funds this time, it kind of, we get a little bit better control of that field where it comes to like people have to get permits. We are gonna do work with the Communications Committee and try to get that out to surrounding towns, because a lot of people go down and do use that field. But that will be something that we'll discuss further moving forward. That was that. And then I just want to talk a minute about, I attended the New Jersey School Board's Legislative Committee last Saturday for about 4 hours. And Senator Vince Gopal is the new education chair, and he actually spoke at this meeting. He wanted to convey at this meeting to thank all the teachers for working tirelessly over the past two or three years now, for all their efforts and everything that they have done. There were some bills that were signed that I'm not going to read through all of them, but one I did want to mention was Board of Ed Student Representatives, S-1219 and A-3392, which I thought is important because they actually passed this bill. But just to show you, Cranford's so far ahead of that, we have our representatives in place. Not only do we have our representatives in place, we have eighth graders coming to our meetings too. So I just think that's important to put out there. I will send the rest of the board the minutes from the past meeting, the legislative committee at the state level. So that's all. Thank you.
Does anybody have any questions for William? Oh. Yeah, go ahead, William.
Sorry. I have one more thing that I just thought was important. A lot of our partners in town are doing scholarships for our seniors. But there's a particular scholarship that I just feel it's important that I bring up this time. The Cranford JCs this year are doing a trade school scholarship, which I think it's important that they kind of went outside the box. I'm not saying that no one else has done that, but I think that's important just to bring that to light, that they are doing a trade school scholarship for our students. And I just want to thank all those, the partners that we have in the town that offer these scholarships for our seniors. Definitely take advantage of them. And again, we want to thank them for doing that because they really raise a lot of money in town to give our seniors, something special. So thank you.
Thank you, William. Does anybody have any questions for William? Does anybody else have any committee reports or old or new business? Okay, all right. Patrick, will you please move the minutes of the previous meetings?
I'd like to make a motion, consideration of the minutes of previous meetings, January 3rd, 2022, reorganization, open work session, 7:05 p.m. January 24th, 2022, regular monthly meeting, 7:30 p.m.
Second.
Anybody have any questions or comments on the minutes?
Okay. Mrs. Carbone.
Yes.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Yes.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mrs. Loiketh.
Yes.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Mallon.
Yes.
Mr. Petchow.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to move on to our formal resolutions. Terry, will you please move resolutions 1 through 9?
My pleasure. I'd like to move resolution 1, business items. Resolution 2, approved revised budget statement 2021-2022. Resolution 3, board secretary's monthly certification budgetary line item status. Resolution 4, acceptance of donations. Resolution 5, approval of Cranford turf field replacement agreement. Resolution 6, approval of student information system maintenance and support contract. Resolution 7, authorizing contracts with certain approved state contract vendors pursuant to NJSA 18A:18A-10A. Resolution 8, approval of travel expenditures. And Resolution 9, field trip destination approval.
Second. Anybody have any questions or comments on 1 through 9?
Mr. Patch, I was just going to say please. that as usual, right, there's, I don't know if there's ever an agenda where we don't comment on the fact that Cranford is a place that is rich in partnerships and being able to get things done. We had already thanked the Township Committee and all the other partners as well. 4 and 5, just another example of our community partners coming together for the benefit of the community as a whole. And I don't know any other community that does that as well as Cranford does. So just another fine example.
Thank you, Dr. Rubin.
Okay. Mrs. Carbone.
Yes.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Yes.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mrs. Loiketh.
Yes.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Mallon.
Yes.
Mr. Petchow.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Brett, will you please move resolutions 10 through 13, and 13 is revised.
Sure. I move 10 HIB decisions, resolution 11, workshop facilitation, resolution 12, textbook adoption, and resolution 13, revised out-of-district placement of special education students.
Second.
I messed that one up anyway, Brett. 13's not revised, 15 is. I just can't read numbers very well.
Yes, you can. We're good.
Anybody have any
questions? It's not revised.
On 10 through 13. We're good.
Okay. Mrs. Carball.
Yes.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Yes.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mrs. Loika.
Yes.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Mallon.
Yes.
Mr. Petchow.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Kristen, will you please move resolutions 14 through 25 and 15 and 18 are revised? Thank you.
I'd like to move resolution 14, approval of substitutes and home instructors, resolution 15, revised retirements, resolution 16, resignation, resolution 17, leave of absence, resolution 18, appointments, resolution 19, revised contract revisions, resolution 20, spring coaching assignments, resolution 21, spring volunteer coaching appointments, resolution 22, 6-period salary adjustments, resolution 23, miscellaneous additional assignment lunchroom, resolution 24, miscellaneous additional assignment central detention, and resolution 25, miscellaneous additional assignment nursing.
Second.
Okay, are you going to do both favors? Thank you.
Hi, everyone. We have some additional assignments for that. So for retirements, we have an add-on. Someone with a teacher with 23 years of experience just retired at Orange School. And then resolution 18, we have an appointment for a long-term sub at Brookside. Thank you.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Mr. Petch, it has to be noted on the revised 15. If you count that up, those five employees, it's almost 150 years worth of experience. I think that says something about a district when you have people that commit to the school district for that many years. And certainly, we wish them well as they embark on this new chapter of their life. We appreciate for the positive impacts they've had on the school. But 150 years, that's pretty great. So we look forward to recognizing them and celebrating them at a future board meeting when we celebrate our Teachers of the Year and also our retirees. So congratulations to them.
Thank you, Dr. Rubin. Does anybody else have any comments or questions? Please, Maria.
I agree. I think it's a testament to our district, our leadership, our morale in the buildings and our families that keep the teachers happy too. 21 years is the lowest, 40 years for Ms. Gilbert. Like, this is amazing. So we're lucky. It's good for the kids when the teachers stick around. It's excellent. Another thing I wanted to note is we're losing Mrs. Penrose, which she teaches family consumer science. Many schools have done away with that and have leaned more towards technology, but just as we were talking about the scholarships for the vocations, we also want to keep our family consumer science, the sewing, the cooking. The fact that our middle schools still have that, I'd like to see more of it. So hopefully we continue with that program because she's a rare find. So hopefully we can, the hard shoes to fill, but hopefully we'll replace her and maybe even extend some of those classes into the high school. Thank you. And congratulations to those amazing accomplishments.
Thank you, Maria. Anybody else?
Okay. Mrs. Carbone.
Yes.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Yes.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mrs. Loika.
Yes.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Mallon.
Yes.
Mr. Petcha.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Marie, will you please move resolutions 26 and 27?
I move resolution 26, policies and regulation for adoption, and 27, job description for adoption.
Second. Any questions on 26 and 27?
All right. Mrs. Carbone.
Yes.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Yes.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mrs. Loika.
Yes.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Mallon.
Yes.
Mr. Petchow.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you, Bob. Okay, that is it for formal resolutions. We are up to our second audience participation. So if anybody would like to come up and comment or ask a question, now is the time, please. Thank you.
Susan Shaw, 27 Windsor Place. I just have a very quick comment. My son received a concussion on the turf this fall, and I just want to extend my gratitude and thanks for the fact that this is being done this year and that it'll be ready for this fall, the next fall season. Just a quick comment, but I do truly appreciate it.
Anybody else? Please.
Tom Grass of Willow Street. Real quickly, just to finish my point before, you know, and to continue with what Dr. Rubin said. And we've all suffered here in one way or another. A lot of people have endured hardships of magnitudes that we never anticipated. We need to heal these wounds. You know, as a community, we need to heal these wounds. And we're blessed in this town to have such outstanding teachers. I mean, really, they're phenomenal. And we're also blessed to have such wonderful students like we saw tonight. And they deserve the best that we can deliver to them. I steadfastly believe that that policy we discussed tonight is divisive. We need to bridge that gap. And I know we're waiting for the state, but it's voluntary. And we really think about that, Cali, it's not just Union County, it's two other counties. The federal government is telling us our county is green. So I would ask that that be brought into consideration. I don't know if it is or not, but it should be. If it's not, it definitely should be, along with all the other CDC inconsistencies we discussed tonight. So please, it's time to come together and let's move on and do what's right. And please reconsider that policy and consider rescinding it immediately. Thanks.
Thank you.
Anybody else want to make comment? Please.
Just two things. Going off of, it's Kenneth Murray, Nolan, 307 Casino. Two things. You're relying on the state of New Jersey, which is still for the test to stay policy, and that's what Dr. Rubin, you had said the reliance is upon. Doesn't really matter because it's a violation of federal law, which again, familiarity with the Constitution seems to be lacking. I don't know if you're still relying on your esteemed counsel here, but again, it's familiarity with the Constitution, which is the highest law in the land. And if you're violating the Constitution and you have a child with a religious exemption and you're going to violate the law by keeping a child out based on discrimination of a religious or medical exemption, and it doesn't matter if you're going to rely on state law. It's a violation of federal law, period. So you're going to get sued. It's very simple. So we're basically telling you the policy that you have in place is unlawful at the federal level. It's pretty simple. You need to change the policy. But on my personal note, before the pandemic, my family is very anti-TV, video games, screen time. My kids didn't have any of those things, tablets. I had 1 hour of TV in the mornings on Saturday. Of course, the pandemic kind of changed things. But my real problem is during recess, my kids have been on their tablets or their Chromebooks, the district-provided Chromebooks, during recess. And my children's father and I have never allowed my kids to have any video games. It's never been something we've provided. We don't believe in that. So I've been a little upset, to say the least, that my children are playing video games during indoor recess, and in particular, video games with shooting in them. There's a game called Five Nights at Freddy's. I have never heard of this until my 8-year-old pointed out to me. An 8-year-old is learning and playing during school in indoor recess on a district-provided Chromebook, shooting games where he's shooting zombies and playing this with all his friends. And again, I think this goes back to all the choices that have been taken away from parents during this pandemic. I've never given my kids video games. Our father's never given them video games. We've never allowed this. And yet in school, on a school-provided computer, my child is playing video games that I would never permit my child to have. And I don't know where the oversight is. I don't know why this is. I mean, when we were kids and we had inside recess, we played 7-Up. Kids put their heads down on the desk and you put your thumb up and the whole thing. And I don't see any of this kind of collaboration. I know at Brookside there was games collected anyway after there was an uproar by parents. My kids never played any of those games. I know we sent in games and they were collected, but according to my two kids, they didn't ever have an opportunity to play this. But I think there has to be some kind of responsibility on the part of the school for, introducing something like that. I mean, again, this is, there's parental rights and they've just been violated across the board. I literally have no comprehension of this, how this is allowed to occur, how there's not some kind of system on a Chromebook. I mean, I have every parental control on my kids' televisions, that anything they have access to, even on my own phone, so my kids can't access things like this. I don't know how the district provided Chromebooks have an 8-year-old who's allowed to have access to a shooting game or a shooting zombies on school time. And that seems atrocious to me. But, you know, every parent does their own thing, but to me that's just, it should just, I don't know how that's permitted. I would love an explanation.
Anybody else have any comments or questions? Please.
Hi, it's Ron Baruti again, speaking strictly as a citizen and taxpayer, 307 Casino Avenue. So I think it was back in August last year, I was in a meeting in the gym, and I remember getting up and speaking and saying to this board that in our system of government, the people have the power, and they created this wonderful system where really it's supposed to be a bottom-up system where the local boards really are the ones that are supposed to have the most power because you're closest to the people. And I said to you then that, you know, you have the opportunity as a board to do something to try to change things that are up above you. And that's sort of the way the system's supposed to be designed. And you're not just supposed to be taking orders. You're supposed to be the ones who are raising the issues with the people above you. So I just I say that because it I did mention in and everyone, I mean, there are multiple people speaking, red light, green light, blue light, whatever it is. That's not a law, okay? I mentioned that there's a federal statute. There's a federal administrative code. Granted that the United States Supreme Court has not ruled on these issues yet, but the federal statute's very plain, and I'd be glad to provide your attorneys with the statutes if you'd like, and the CFR. But the EUA statute's very clear that every single person has a right to say no, and regulation that goes with it for informed consent is that every single person who says no has an absolute right to go on living their lives without punishment. At some point or other, some child or some children in this school district are going to be punished for choosing not to be vaccinated under the current state of the new rule. And I just think that it's disappointing to hear that after saying that and after hearing the people speak that, well, we're listening to the state health department and there's new guidance and maybe things will be green light soon. And that's nice. But you're the people with the power. And if there's something wrong with what you're being told to do, it's your obligation to raise it. And you have the ability to say, Governor, wait a minute, this is wrong. And again, you shouldn't be a rubber stamp for something illegal. And I respectfully suggest that by just saying we're going to wait for state guidance or this and that and the other thing, I just think you're being a rubber stamp. And I think that you're really doing things you shouldn't do. And every single one of you also has a right to dissent. If there's someone who here on this board hears something that's going to be, something's going to be passed that you think isn't right, you have a right to dissent, and you have a right to raise the issue and say, you know what, I think it's wrong, and I think we ought to do something about it. And I ask you as local residents and community members who have this important, you know, responsibility, and your volunteers, and I appreciate all that. You have this important responsibility. Raise your voices. If you believe there's something wrong, raise your voices, because you're the ones who are in this position of power, and you are the closest to the people, and you, therefore, are the people with the most power in the country in a lot of ways. Thank you.
Anybody else have any questions or comments? Please.
I don't have anything magnanimous to say. I just really liked the description of the course that you were talking about, and I would love to see it continue because I have a middle schooler coming up, and I thought it was really cool. And there's not really a lot of support for programs like that, and there's no middle schools to do it, so I just wanted to put my vote out there.
Anybody else have any comments? We're good. Do you want to just respond to that stuff?
Yeah, sure. So, there we go. With the issue that was raised at the school with the Chromebook, certainly we'll look into that. But I would ask that you reach out to the school directly and have that conversation so they can specifically address it. But we will certainly take a look at it and see if there's a, you know, what that yields. But certainly, please reach out to the school directly so that they can assist you.
Any board member have any comments? Okay,
can I just say one thing?
Please.
So, Ms. Puglisi, regarding FCS and what Mrs. Lickwith had talked about before, just so you know, part of what is, you know, in the referendum discussion is making updates to the FCS classrooms. I'm a member of the Buildings and Grounds Committee, and I was able to spend some time in those classrooms. The ovens, the cabinets, a lot of the things are antiquated, meaning older than 20, maybe even older than 30 years old. So as the referendum is talked about later in the year, know that those and, you know, funding for those type of things are in that. And so look for that, please. Thanks.
Thank you, Terry. Anybody else? No, we're good. All right. We do not need a second executive session. So I need a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, everyone, and be safe. Thank you, Chris.